just keep my, let me take it off. That's fine.
What about this way?
It's fine. Salu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billahi al-aliyyi al-azim. وصلى الله على محمد وعلى اله الطيبين الطاهرين
اللهم صل على
محمد وعلى اله الطيبين
कोई बात नहीं शुरू कर दे
Mainly, Urdu is my first language because I live
more than almost 20 years in Karachi. But Alhamdulillah, we are here for this great occasion. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about his bounties on several places in the Holy Quran. For example, when we start the Quran and talks about the bounties at the last part of Surah Al-Fatiha, and unto alayhim. And then one of the verses which most of our young children, they know by heart as well, Al-Yawma Atmantu Lakum Dinakum Wa Atmantu Lakum Ni'mati. Is another name there. But if I, after doing this istifadah from my teachers, if I have to just count one bounty from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which we cannot pay the price at all, no one can pay that price, that is the basis of the Holy Prophet. That is the thing. Even though we have got the day of Qadim, when the Holy Prophet, with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, announced the wilaya of Amir al-Mu'mineen, that is greatest day. But that is the istimrar, the continuity of Baisat-e Rasul. That is not something else. So inshallah ta'ala, in the first section, I'll be giving just few of the information. And in the second section, I'll try to bring few points, what is actually Baisat. And in the last part, which is last 10-15 minutes, I will tell you a story from the Quran, which is again about the Baisat. And then in the final 2-3 minutes of conclusion, what did we learn from this speech, or what did we learn from our own life? Inshallah, the children, they will come and they will, you inshallah, pay attention when we say Allahu Salawat. The word in the Quran, Ba'atha, all three words with the Fatha, Ba, Ayn, and Tha. Ba'atha. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used in the Quran 67 times. And out of those 67 times, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used Ba'atha as fail, as verb, 52 times. And rest of the 15 times are sometimes noun, adjective, and adverb. But what does Ba'atha mean? It is impossible to translate Quran into any other language. It is almost impossible, but I'm not denying the translation. Translations are very good, especially for people like me whose Arabic is their not first language. It's hard for us to understand Quran without translating, but some of the gestures and some of the words are almost impossible to translate in any other language. Even though after Arabic language, Persian is the best language, which can take most of the Arabic mafaheem meanings into it. And after that is Urdu language, because Urdu basically is a combination of 3-4 languages. Main language is Arabic, then Urdu, then Sanskrit, and some of the local languages combine them together and becomes Urdu. So Urdu is very vast in that sense, because it can take and adopt words from other languages very easily. But for example, I'll just give you one example. When we want to emphasize on certain things, for example, if I want to say you have to do this, for example, if I'm speaking myself, in that case, with my attitude, with my expression, you get a message which you cannot get this message from the book. It's impossible. For example, if me or anybody, say for example, if a brother is giving command to us, do this certain thing. When the brother is giving the command, and if he writes the same command on a piece of paper, then these are two different things. Because when the person is saying something, that is totally different thing. Same way, sometime Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala emphasize on a few things. Now, alhamdulillah, I know that we have some Arabic, inshallah. I will apologize to them if I make any mistake in Arabic language, inshallah. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala emphasizes in the Holy Quran, he uses the word, for example, inna. Alif with kasra and noon with shadda and fatha. Inna. Inna means, if we translate it into English, indeed,
verily. But the expression which Inna gives, we can't understand that. And translating even, not even Arabic language, any other language from one language to another language, it's like you putting these ether, these perfumes from one bottle to another bottle. Whatever you do, still there's some perfume left in the bottle which you are putting from one to another. That's how difficult the translation is. That's why, especially Shaykh Murtaza Mutahari used to say that Quranic Arabic is the most easiest Arabic to learn. Because he was Ayatollah, he's a great scholar, and there's one sentence for the praise of Shaykh Murtaza Mutahari is enough, which is said by Khomeini, Imam Kabir, what he said, that if there is any doctor who can put on somebody's pulse, his finger, and can tell that what kind of disease this person has, then Mutahari is the doctor of Islam. He can put his fingers on the pulse of Islam and he can tell that if this is right or wrong. That is one of the reasons this great personality got killed. And he was killed by one of his students, so-called student. These are the great personalities. Whenever we get together, because they are the continuity of this Bezat. This is not like admiring one person. It's not about that. It's about the mansab, where the person is sitting, and with what honesty that person is sitting. And for only two people, Imam Khomeini used the word, my son, I lost my son. One is for Shahid Husseini from Pakistan, and one is this great personality, Shahid Mutahari. When they both got killed, Imam Khomeini said that I've lost my son today. So when it comes to Arabic language, and especially Quranic language, Quran has its own way of describing anything. When the Holy Quran was revealed to the Holy Prophet, even though these old words like Ya Lamuna, Ta Lamuna, Inna Allah, Inna, Anna, Kanna, these old words, all the Arabs, they used to use these words. But the combination which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made and revealed on the heart of the Holy Prophet, that is the miracle of Quran. Same words. Where is fasaha and balagha? For example, a person like me who is saying these words and just putting here and there and trying to convey my message. But at the same time, if somebody with the fasaha and balagha who comes and use exactly the same word, the feeling will be totally different. What is ba'atha? If we just put few minutes on the life of the Holy Prophet, we see that the Holy Prophet was born in a society where there is absolutely no law. Nobody used to care about anyone. All the people, they used to, any person who's with the power and the status used to get all the benefits. Now, first time in the history when we see the Holy Prophet on some sort of big scale, that is the first one, the agreement of Fuzul, hateful Fuzul. When the Holy Prophet was only 20 years of age. And that time, most of the caravans to do trade into other countries, those caravans were not safe. And those caravans used to get polluted and plundered. So, some of the Arabs, they got together and they said we should make an agreement that these caravans should be protected and they should work normally because it's a benefit for all the humanity, at least in that area. So the very first agreement took place because among those people they were doing this agreement, there were three people, their name was Fazl. So that's why it's called Fuzul, the plural for Fazl. And the Holy Prophet was the person who went from the Bani Hashims. He was only 20 years old, a young boy. He went and the Holy Prophet went and he participated in that Hilful Fuzul. And he said, this, if there's any agreement which can give some sort of calmness to the humanity, the son of Abdullah is always available for that. What's the message for us? Now here, in 2016, we have to open our heart, our hands, for all the human beings. Islam, despite being different race in Islam, despite being non-Muslim, Jews, Christian, open your heart for everyone. Because when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuhal nas, all the human beings. It doesn't say, Ya ayyuhal muslimun, or Ya ayyuhal shia. No, it's for everyone. So we have to open our centers, our hearts, for everyone. When Imam Khomeini, Rahmatullah, when he stood up, he didn't call, Ya ayyuhal tashayyu, no. He didn't say, Ya ayyuhal muslimun, no. He said, Ya ayyuhal dhuafa ad-dunya. Oh, the weak people of the world. We should never get stuck. Unfortunately, we see in our surrounding people, they are stuck in their little dungeon. We should not get stuck in this little dungeon. For example, Alhamdulillah, in a month's time, the great month of Allah, Ramadan is coming. And the last Friday, we all do this march of Yawm al-Qudus. So many people, they create friction among the Sunnis and Shia, say, look, Shia, they don't care about you. No, for last over 30 years, all the Shia get together and they stand against the oppression of Israel. For who? Palestine. Palestine is not a Shia state. But at the same time, we heard this message from who? From Amir al-Mu'mineen. When he was on his shahadat bed, on his deathbed, he said, O Hassan and O Hussein, be friend to Mazloom and be enemy to Zalim. We have a very clear message. Quran is for whole humanity. Quran is for jinn as well, but jinn is not known for us. So there is absolutely no point to talk about them. So many people, they spend their lot of time, what the jinns are doing, what they eat, how they get married, how their children come into the world. Baba, that's got nothing to do with you. Just think about humanity. Yes, they are with us. They are the second mukallaf. They are with takleef like us. But if they were, well, I don't know nothing about jinns. If somebody knows, inshallah, will give me some information, will say Allahu salawat. Inshallah, what is actually bith mean? If you see the translation in the Quran, there are so many, sometimes there, for example, in Surah Al-Jumu'ah, verse number 2, say, هُوَ الَّذِي بَعْثَ فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ رَسُولٌ مِّنْهُمْ يَتْلُوْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِي وَيُزَكِّي وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ. In that verse, again, the word بَعْثَ being used. When you see the different translation in English, in Urdu, or any other language, you said that Allah is the one who sent. Allah is the one who sent most of the places. But this is not the meaning of Ba'tha. One of the translation, I was looking to the translation day before yesterday, and one of the alim put, Allah is the one who raised up. This is very near to Ba'tha. What does raised up mean? For example, we are some people sitting in this room. For example, all of us are sleeping, just for the example's sake. If a little child comes from outside and say, God forbid, there is a fire outside, everybody will forget the sleeping and the person is going to stand up. Yes? What did this child do? This child did the betha. He raised up to make the people aware. When the Holy Prophet came into Mecca, Umul Qura of that time, most of the people, so in Surah Yasin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, there was no warner came to them before. So they all were sleeping, mentally sleeping. They were eating, they were drinking, they were getting married, and there was so many children coming into the world because of them. But at the same time, they were just sleeping. They didn't have any clue. They had so many bad habits. For example, you heard this incident, God knows, thousand times from the pulpit, and you have read in the books and from the television, that they used to bury their alive daughters. بِأَيَّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ. Quran tells us in Surah Al-Takwir, بِأَيَّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ. It will be asked on the day of judgment that why these girls got killed. When this holy prophet came, they used to kill their young daughters. They used to loot and plunder all the caravans. They had absolutely no respect towards the humanity. They even used to marry and get the inheritance their stepmothers. For example, a person had 3-4 wives and he dies, he's got 3 sons left. Apart from their own mother, those children's own mother, they used to own and get these inheritance, their stepmother in their inheritance. So that kind of the society where the Holy Prophet came, and he has to do this bay'athah. He has to raise up himself and he has to make the other people raise up. Now this bay'athah doesn't stop with the Holy Prophet's demise. It doesn't stop with the shahada of Amir al-Mumin Imam Hassan, or even with the disappearance or occultation of the 12th Imam. It doesn't finish. It's still going on. Inshallah, I'll give you the example. So when Holy Prophet came in the society, if Holy Prophet was a political leader, he had so many scenarios to stand upon them and get the maximum votes. For example, he could have stood for slavery, because there are so many people, they were slaves. He could have stood for just the women, because there were so many women, they got oppressed. Hazrat Sumayya, the mother of Ammar Yasir, she said herself that I was the 4th daughter of my father. Before me, my father buried 3 daughters. And when he was burying me, he buried me up to the neck. And I thought my father is playing with me. And she said that I was about 3 or 4. And I said, father, are you playing with me? And my father burst into tears and he couldn't bury me. He took me back. In that kind of society, where there was absolutely no respect for women, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the Holy Prophet the daughter Fatima to Zahra subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is the honor of this great lady? Just think about this honor. If the Holy, when she was very young, like 4 or 5, whenever she used to come to the father, the Holy Prophet used to stand and used to cuddle her, kiss her. Even though when she was the mother of Imam Hassan and Imam Hussain, she was about 15 years of age, 14, 15, still used to respect her. Some of the companions asked the Holy Prophet, is this for every daughter? Holy Prophet said, no, it's not for this respect. This ta'zeem is not for every daughter. But at the same time, Holy Prophet says that if a person has 3 daughters and he never get disheartened from that, he try to bring them up very nicely and make them marry, that person will be with me in the paradise like these 2 fingers. So what kind of society the Holy Prophet came? There is absolutely no respect for slaves, no respect for women, and the Holy Prophet put them as the best person. Now we see later on the daughter of Janabi Fatima Tuzara, Janabi Zainab, Janabi Kulsum, Janabi Rubaiya. So many other great ladies. And from them, then we have so many. One of the servant maid of Bibi Fatima, Janabi Fizza. These ladies has great state. Even though when Imam Hussain al-Islam going for this so-called, it wasn't a battle. It was the second bay'athah of the Rasul, after the Rasul. Because the whole nation was sleeping when Imam Hussain al-Islam went into Mecca for the pilgrimage. And during the pilgrimage, when he stopped and he said, I'm not going to be performing, because even though this earth is pure, is clean, is pure, is tahir, but the roof on this earth is called Yazid, and he is the most najis. He is the najasa. Under this najasa, Hajj cannot be performed. So he, Imam Hussain al-Islam, done the same bay'athah which the Holy Prophet did 50 years before. The people were sleeping that time. Now, the train of the Islam was totally gone other way. You know the difference between train and car? If you go to a junction, if you are in a car, you can take L-shaped bend on a car. Even the passenger sitting next to you, the passenger knows that you have done left or right. But if you are sitting on a train, train never takes a sudden bend. Train always takes a long bend. That's how Islam was bended, and it went back to the same place, the Dawr-e Jahiliyyah, in 50 years. Who were the people? Too nicely, you know. Don't want to take anybody's name. But those people, they thought Ali is a young person. He is only 30 in his early 30s. This person is not suitable for so many reasons as the Khalifa or the successor of the Holy Prophet. First of all, he killed people in thousands, and most of their relatives, they are under the government of the Islam now. So as they portrayed these things, the other things they said, Ali is a very jolly man. The other thing they said that Ali is very young. But then Amir Mumin, according to Ibn Qatayba, he said it. If this mansab, if this appointment is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then what is that goes through with age? If it's not from Allah, then I don't care. So in 50 years' time, we see the Holy Prophet, after the Holy Prophet, we see that the whole Islamic train has gone back to square one, back to the same place where the Holy Prophet started. Now the daughters were getting killed, but some other ways. That was the base of the second base of the Holy Prophet. Now, this time, the base happened through Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Because most of the people, they were sleeping. Even three Abdullah, in Mecca, they said to Imam Hussein, Abdullah ibn Amr or Umar, Abdullah ibn Zubair, and Abdullah ibn Abbas. These three people came to Imam Hussein alayhi salam. And he said, Ya Hussein, can't you see these people are not loyal? They were not loyal to your father. The people in Kufa, they will betray you. And Imam Hussein alayhi salam said a sentence with such a grief. He said, at least consider me as yourself. I have the basira like you at least. You do not take me as Imam Ma'asum, but at least you should consider me as much as you know. And then the second thing, Abdullah ibn Abbas said, Mawla, if you are going, in that case, do not take your women, especially your sister. And then Bibi was listening to this, and Bibi said that, Abdullah, if you don't want to come, it's up to you. But do not say these kind of things to my brother. And Imam Hussein said, the mission I'm going to, never be successful without Zainab. Because Besa is totally different. That was the second. I just talk about the third Besa. But before that, if you say Lord Sawad, I just gave you a little incident from the Quran. This incident, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described, I think I don't have enough time, I try to just give you the translation, inshallah. This incident is described, inshallah, all the youngsters, please go to verse number 246 to 251 in Surah Al-Baqarah, the second surah of the Quran. We know that Surah Al-Baqarah is the longest surah of the Quran, which contains 286 verses. The shortest surah is Surah Al-Kawthar, which has three verses. By the same time, we have few more, like Surah Al-Quraysh, it has three verses, but the wordings are a bit more. The longest one is Surah Al-Baqarah, and the shortest one is Surah Al-Kawthar. Verse number 246 to 251. Just give you the translation, there's not enough time left. Some of the book says the prophet of that times, it was sometime happened after Prophet Moses, before Prophet David and Solomon. We know Prophet Salman and Prophet Dawud alayhi salam. In Prophet Dawud's time, but after the time of Musa, this incident took place. Some of the Tafaseer books tell the name of this prophet is Prophet Shemuel. The people, the big people, Quran say Al-Mala, the big people, the influential people. Every community has few influential people. The most influential people among the Jewish society of that time, obviously Judaism and Christianity, in their original shape, these both religions are Islam. When there was a corruption in Judaism, then came Jesus. And when there was corruption in Judaism and Christianity, then came Prophet Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has got one personality left. God forbid that, inshallah, we must be among those people who will be the helper and the servant of Imam Zamana. Otherwise, there is one Numanda Ilahi still sitting and waiting for that proper time to come. So these people, the Mala, they came to the Prophet of that time and they said, we are here because this army of Jalut, which in English you say Goliath, the army of Goliath, they are so oppressive towards us. So we want you pray for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make a leader among us. So under the supervision of that leader, we should fight. Muhammad, you have probably read and heard this incident 1,000 times. I want to take out something which is a little message after that. So the Holy Prophet said that I worry. Now this is a straight translation. If you read inshallah, you're going to find the same translation. And when I say translation, doesn't come to some up to some extent. But alhamdulillah, we the people, we need translation to understand Quran. I'm not against the translation. Obviously, ulama, they have done a great job. And all they are doing, they are making Allah's message easy for us to understand. So we cannot say that the translations are wrong. They came. The Holy Prophet of that time, he said that I'm worried about this thing that you are asking for jihad fi sabilillah, to fight in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But when it prescribed to you by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when it becomes wajib to you, you will deny that. And they all looked at each other and said, how could we deny? These are the words in the Quran. So how could we deny when we've been dragged out from our houses, our cities, we are living in the jungle, and they have taken our children, our daughters and our girls. They're killing our sons, and they are keeping our girls as slaves. So there is a great blow in it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran. The Prophet says, okay, I will pray for you. Next time when they met the Prophet, they saw a young man sitting next to the Prophet, and he was a very, very poor person. Even the clothes were very, very old, and he was just a shepherd. The person who was sitting next to the Prophet, Shemoyo. And when these mala came to all the group of people, they came to the Prophet and said that, yes, did you pray from Allah? Said, yes, I pray from Allah, and the prayer was accepted, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you a leader. And they all looked at each other and said, who is it? And the Prophet said, this person sitting on my left or my right. They looked at him, said, we don't know him. We don't know him. We thought that you're going to make this leader among us, from us. This person, we can't see any wealth in him. Look at his clothes. Full of the stitches. Look at him. And the Holy Prophet replied, Allah has given him two things which you don't have. The shuja'ah, the bravery, and the knowledge which you don't have. We see same thing happen after the demise of the Holy Prophet. That wonderfully poor person, he had knowledge and bravery more than anyone. Even the enemy accepted it. But they didn't put him there. One of my scholars say this is very ajab. It's amazing. The Muslim says, Al-Hasan wal-Husayn, Sayyid al-Shabab al-Jannah, that they are the master of the youth of the paradise. But this little dunya, ad-dunya daniya, this adna, this lower position, they don't want to offer them. That's amazing. That's how human become amazing. So they said that how could you make this person as our leader? He hasn't got any wealth, no status, nobody knows. He's not popular. Brothers and sisters, I'm telling you this story, inshallah, for a reason. Because sometimes anyone who comes to this pulpit and saying he has to say what is the reality. Instead of making people sleep, no, this is not the job of anybody who's coming here. Anybody. More than half people, they said that because the leader is not from us, we are not participating. They said, we are not going. Half of the people left. Half of the people, they looked at each other. They said that we ask from the Prophet. Now this is coming from the Prophet by the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We must accept that. So because of the embarrassment, they accepted. And then the Holy Prophet said that I give you a sign for the tranquility of your heart. What is the sign? That the tabut, the coffin of Musa and Harun's children, which is full of the barakat, he will bring it back and all the angels there will be lifting. These are the simple translations, inshallah, we'll find it. Verse 246 to 251. So those people said, okay, we will go and fight against Goliath, Jalut. While they were traveling, now here is amazing point here. When they were traveling, he was at the front, who? Talut, the new leader. He was at the front. He was going with them. Suddenly, he said, everybody stop. It was a very, very hot day. I know in this country, thinking about thirst is very, very difficult. Inshallah, the time is coming, the month of Ramadan, then we have some idea about the thirst. Some idea, still not. Because if you want to know what thirst is, then you should go to Saudi Arabia or Pakistan or some other hot country of the world. Then you will know what is actually thirst. So anyway, Talut apartheid himself. He stood on the side and he said that, now Quran says that Talut made himself apart from them. He stood there and said, not in a while. I know you are very tired. I know you are very thirsty. I know you are very hungry. But I'm telling you this thing, that in a while you're going to find an oasis where you're going to find a very nice cold water and some fruits and all the things like that. But do not drink from that water. That's a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if you really are dying because of the test, just take one ghurfa, one palm, just so you can just put some water into your throat. And if you drink from that water, for example, you are not from me. And if you don't drink, then you are with me. Everybody said, okay, we will not be drinking. But half of the people left when the Holy Prophet announced another leader. More than half of the people, because kam min fiyatin, that's what Quran says, a little group of young people, kam min fiyatin, a very young group. Apart from that young group, most of the people, when they saw the water, they couldn't resist. They threw themselves onto the water. They start drinking. And they were drinking. They drank that much. Most of the people, they drank. They couldn't even stand up. There were only 12, 15, or maybe 20. I don't know the number, but very tiny minority. They were standing next to Talut. Everybody drank, and they drank too much. So it was difficult for those few people to carry them. Now they had to carry them. So anyway, they came to the other side of the canal. Other side, they saw that Jalut is standing with all of his army and all the weapons of that time. When these people looked at them and said, wow, Talut, you didn't tell us that we have to fight that big army. We are not able to do that. These are the words in the Quran. We are not able to do that. We are not fighting. When it comes to that, only one person stood up. وَقَتَلَ دَعُودُ جَالُوتَ. Because Talut said, who is going to be standing? At the same time, Jalut, like Amr ibn Abd was, when he crossed that trench and he said, instead of killing all the Muslims, just send one, kill me and finish. There will be no war. Same way, Jalut said, just send one person, I fight with the person. If the person killed me, The whole war is yours. Only one masoom came, and that was Prophet Dawood. He killed him. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that I gave him the kingdom and the hikmah. Now again and again, if you read these verses of Baisa, again and again Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that we mab'ud this Rasul for what? To purification, hikmah, ta'aleem, these are the things. Now, brothers and sisters, we are living in 2016. This is the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every single person on the face will be tested. Every single blink of our eyes, we will be tested. We have to see that where is that test. Now here, we are so lucky. Why we are so lucky? Especially after the Islamic revolution in Iran. Forget Iran. If we say that there was a revolution only in Iran, then I have to say that then the Prophet is only for the Arabs. The Imam is only for the Arab. No. These universal personalities are not for one nation or one little communities. They are for the whole humanity. Or if I go a bit further, say they are for the whole creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are so lucky. Can we see any talut around us? We have to make sure that we not be behaving. The people behave with talut. There is a talut this time as well. You find yourself who's talut these days. And that is only going to come. وَالَّذِي بَعْثَ فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ. We have to get the knowledge. We have to purify ourselves. We have to gain this hikmah. And after that, we come to the point where we can see haq and batil, and we will be the qari to distinguish between haq and batil. That was the message of Baisa, in my very, very humble opinion. And inshallah, I will pray for myself and to all the brothers and sisters for you. Inshallah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us this time. So we really, because we have tons of treasures, the knowledge. Just after the Quran, if you want to understand Quran, go to Najul Balagha. Najul Balagha will tell you what Quran is. And if you want to know what is Dua-i Kamal, we just had Dua-i Kamal a while ago. If you want to know what Dua-i Kamal is, go to Sahifa Sajjadiyah. These three, four books, it's not easy to understand the Quran, not easy to understand Najul Balagha, same time, Sahifa Sajjadiyah, and so many. But Alhamdulillah, the environment we are living in, we spend our best 20 years for all the education which will finish when I die. But at least, I'm not saying inshallah, you should be doctor, you should be accountant, you should be engineer, politician, technician, whatever the knowledge is. This is all fazl according to the saying of the Holy Prophet, but at the same time, please do not forget your roots. Knowledge, as the Holy Prophet said, Ana madinatul ilm wa aliyun babuha. Ana darul hikmah wa aliyun babuha. These things will come with the tawassul of masumeen alayhi salam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the strength. So inshallah, we really gain the pure knowledge and we bring that knowledge into the practice, because actions speak louder than the words. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.